how kind he is. I love him so much. What a wonderful Savior we have also. What a great God he is. Tonight, you don't want to miss tonight. If you haven't been to church lately on a Sunday night, don't miss. The Bible says in the book of James, if you draw near to God, he will draw near to you. So tonight we're just going to have a drawing near service. And I believe it'll be wonderful. Prophetic will be here. And most of important, the Holy Spirit will be here. So you don't want to miss it. Well, God is good. He's an amazing God. He's a God of faithfulness. And let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus this morning. We thank you, Lord, that you are our God, that you are everything we say you are. And we ask you, Lord, that you would plant this word deep within our hearts this very morning, that we would be those overcomers that you have called us to be. I thank you, Lord, and I bless you with everything within me in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, you know, I love to meditate on the Word of God, because if you meditate upon the Word of God, it gets in your heart and it becomes life to you. And as I was meditating upon the very Word of God, he told me, my tomorrows will become today. And many times when we're believing for something, and my little great-granddaughter that lives with us, Aria, and her dear mother, you tell her, Ari, now, we're going to do this tomorrow. And she says, no, not tomorrow, today. Because when you're little like that, your tomorrows are today. You want it right now. And it's hard to understand tomorrow when you live in today. You know, a little one lives in today. They don't live in the fear of tomorrow. They're right now. And we have a God that's a right now God. But when we're believing God for our tomorrow, which we've been praying for to happen today, there is an interim period. And that period between the promise and the very fulfillment of that promise is always, there's always things in between that you have to get to the place in Christ that you can live in the fullness of him in that in-between moments. And not always the in-between time for the fulfillment of the promise to come to pass is pleasant. I don't know if you've ever been there, but I've had many promises from the Lord that I kept in my heart, but in the interim period waiting for that fulfillment to come, it was not an easy time. So today we're going to look at the scriptures and we're going to see what we must do while we're waiting for the possession to come to us. And see, there's so many promises in the Word of God that he has given to us in the Old and the New Testament. There's promises of healing. There's promises of victory, of a sound mind. There's promises of prosperity. There's promises maybe he's called you to do something and it hasn't happened yet. And you're waiting on that to come to pass. Maybe some of you have been called to pastor or to be an evangelist, maybe minister the very word of God, and it hasn't happened yet. But I can tell you, if he's placed it in your heart and he's given you that promise, it will surely come to pass. But you have to do something in the interim period. The Bible says in Galatians 3:29 that if we are Christ, if we are Christ, we are a seed of Abraham, and we are heirs according to the promise. So Abraham is our father. He was the first father of faith that we can look at. And if we are Christ, the Bible says we are heirs to the promise. Everything that was promised Abraham, everything God did in Abraham's life, he wants to do the same in ours. He wants to bless us. He wants to multiply us. He wants to bless us with blessing upon blessing upon blessing. Galatians 3:9 says, to those who are faithful, you are blessed with believing Abraham. So I would believe if the Lord is that sincere about Abraham and all that he did for him, I believe we need to look at Abraham's life to see what went on in his life. In the book of Hebrews, if you would turn to that, chapter 6, verse 12, it says that ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Now, if you look at these two words, faith and patience, they are really a power team, because you can't have faith without patience. And I know faith is now, but now does not always happen now. Even though God has planned it for the now, it might not be now. And so for the now to come to your life, you have to walk in that spirit of patience. And I know for some of us, it's very difficult to have patience. And it's a learned thing, patience. Have you ever been to McDonald's in the line? And you order your food, and the line is very long, and it's hard to have patience. Have you waited in line, and you have to have patience? Have you waited beside your microwave as you're fixing something, and you have to have patience for that? And you can punch in 2 minutes, and it seems like all eternity. Well, I waited for God to save our oldest son for over 13 years, and when it happened, it was wonderful. Wonderful. So the wait, you know, when it does happen, it's like we dreamed a dream. How can this be, God? It's so good. It has happened. You're living. You know what Job said? After everything of Job's troubles, he said, Lord, now I have seen you with the very seeing of my eye. I desire you, Lord, more than my necessary food. When you get to the place that you desire him more than the answer to the promise, it will come. But when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself. And this is what he told him. Surely, saying, surely, blessings I will bless you, and multiplying I will multiply thee. And so after he had patiently endured, now that's a hard statement right there. After he had patiently endured for 24 years, patiently endured, he obtained the promise. In other words, he got a hold of it. Everything that he went to get the promised seed, Isaac, he finally got it. I know when our daughter-in-law was expecting our grandson, one of our first few, and she said she was going to name him Isaac. And I prayed and I says, Lord, Isaac, that's a wonderful name. That's a son of promise. And the Lord spoke to me. He says, your Isaac shall be a delight to you, and he will be a delight. And I can tell you, he is a delight. He is a delight. So Isaac, the promised seed, how do we wait in the interim period? What do we do to get the promises to come closer, to happen right now? Well, the Bible is very plain upon that, clear upon that. And let's turn to the patriarch Abraham. His life was an illustrious example of one who endured and obtained the promise. So if you will turn to chapter 12, verse 1, we'll take a look at him. And you know, you can't help but like Abraham. Here he lived 175 years old. You know, Sarah, his wife, went on. And he married again. And he had 6 more children. How about that? So he had 8 in all. And, you know, those that he gave birth to. And the Bible says that he lived a full life, 175 years. And when it was time for him to go on, that his sons, Ishmael and Isaac, they buried him. Chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord had said unto Abraham, get thee out. Get thee out. Have you ever heard the Lord tell you, get thee out? In other words, he's telling him, get away from some things. Get away from some of your kinfolks. Now see, the enemy can bring someone into your life, and at first you think that person's a blessing, and you can help that person, and you can do everything you know to bless that person, but it could be an assignment from the enemy. So he had to get out. He had to get out from his country, his fellow men. He had to get out from his father's house, and he had to go where God was going to show him to go. And see, you're blessed today because you're in here in a house of faith. You're in a good church filled with the power and the anointing and the glory of God. And I'd rather be in this church than any other. So you're blessed that the Lord has put you here. Can somebody say amen to that? Okay. And he says, and I will make of thee a great nation. And I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless you, and I will curse them that curse you. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So the Bible says Abram departed. And at this time when the promise came to him, he was 75 years old. Now, I don't think most of us would want to wait till we're 75 years old to get the promise. Do you really think we'd want to wait that long? Huh? I don't think so. But here he's 75 years old with no children. Sarah was barren. She couldn't give birth. And all of a sudden at 75, God tells him to get out of where you were, where there was idol worship and where he lived. Get away, and I'm going to bless you. And I'm going to make a great nation out of you. Now, if it were me, I'd probably be thinking, oh, my goodness, how many children can I have at one time to have a nation? You know, you think, oh, my, in my lifetime. And bless him. And then in verse 7, and the Lord appeared unto Abram and said unto him, thy seed I will give this land. And there he built an altar. So we can see two things right here in Abram's life. Number one, he obeyed God to get the promise. And number two, he built an altar, a place of worship, a place of sacrifice, a place of thanksgiving. He built an altar. So we must have that obedience in our life to follow after our God with everything within us. Because God wants to bless you. He wants to multiply you. He wants to give you the kingdom. He wants you to inherit blessings. He wants the very Spirit of God to be upon you and touch you and fill you. And he asks for you to desire him. And then in Genesis 13, we see here in verse 14, and the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him. Now Lot had to be removed from him. There wasn't room for both of them on the land. You know that story. He says, lift up thine eyes. Now see, a lot of us were looking at the negative instead of the positive. We've waited a long time. Maybe we've waited 24 years. Maybe we've waited 30 years. Maybe we've waited 6 months or 3 months or 2 months. And we're believing God for something and the promise hasn't come yet, the fulfillment. And we're growing weary. He says, you got to change your outlook. You got to look different. You got to look at something else instead of the problem. If I keep looking at the problem is going to become a monster, and the problem will eventually eat me. So I feed the problem by meditating upon it. If I meditate upon my lack, what I don't have, what I haven't received, what I can't do or I won't do, and if I meditate upon that, if I meditate upon what somebody has called me or said about me, or some maybe doctor report that I've received. If I meditate upon that, it will get larger and larger and larger till it will eventually consume me and I'll live in that instead of the blessings and the power of God. So I think we better take off some things that the enemy has tried to put on us, and we need to walk with a new walk, talk with a new talk, and grab a hold of God. He says, lift up thine eyes and look from the place where you are. So I'm in a place right now, and the blessings and the promise is over here. So I need to start looking at the promise instead of where I am now. I can stay here and I can meditate upon that, or I can look at the promises of God and I can look at the blessings. I can look at the healing. I can look at the victory. I can look at what God said his word has for me, and I will live in that instead of living in the negative. It's how you think. It's how you see. So God is getting him to look. You got to look to God's word. You got to believe God's word. You got to act upon it. He says to look. He says, look north, south, east, west. For all the land which you see, I will give it to you and to your seed. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth. Here the man has no, he's telling me he's going to have dust of the earth. What? How can that be? Jeff, I will bless you. I will bless your business. I will pour prosperity upon you. The blessings of God will be upon you because you've obeyed me, says the word. And then he tells him in verse 17, arise and walk. Arise and walk. Get up from where you are now. Don't stay seated in the enemy's seat. I can sit in the enemy's seat and I can stay there, and that problem's going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. Or I can rise up. And I can stand tall and I can stand strong in this word of God. And I can believe what God said. And I can grab a hold of those promises. And they will come to pass in my life. He says, look, see, lift up. In other words, do something. You know, you think about Joseph. Joseph was in the pit. But I don't believe he lived in the pit. I believed he looked toward the palace because he had a dream. He had a dream, and everybody tried to steal the dream from him, but he wouldn't let them. He hung on to the dream until the day came that he was in the palace. You can look at David, King David. Here, he was anointed with oil. You're the king. You're going to be the king. And here, it didn't happen. Instead, the present king was chasing him and trying to kill him. I can't imagine what it would be like if Obama's out trying to kill the next president. Can you imagine? That's a wild thought, but that's what David was going through. The king was trying to kill. It was a process from the very shepherd boy to the king. And what did he do? I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. He continually blessed his God. He blessed him. He says, arise and walk, arise and walk. And then if you will turn to Genesis 15, verse 1, after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. In other words, you don't have any children yet, but you better look to me. Your answer is always in God. It's not in flesh. It's not in the world. It's in God. He says, I am your shield. I am your exceedingly great reward. He will do abundantly above all that you ask or think, according to the power that works in you. It's like a dynamo working in you. And the more word you feed yourself the word, and you feed the word, and that dynamo is working in you, and it's churning, and it's bringing the things of the word to come to pass in your life. What you can see, you can have. What you can feel and taste, and you can become that. The word, there's victory in the word, there's life in the word. There's power in the very word of God to bring the fulfillment of the promises in this word. And this is what Abram said to him. And Abram said, Lord God, what will thou give me? What will thou give me? He's getting weary here in chapter 15. The promise hasn't come. The seed, Isaac, hasn't been born yet. It's not happening, and he's getting older, and he has these promises. And you know, he birthed Ishmael, and that wasn't the promise. But he's asking God, what will you give me? And then here's what he says, seeing I go childless. So right here, he wasn't seeing the promise right now. He was seeing the lack. Seeing, if I look at it, if I see it, if I see the lack, I'll live in it. He says, seeing I go childless, what are you going to give me, God? And here God had promised him all these wonderful promises. Your seed is going to be blessed. They're going to inherit the earth. I'll multiply you. I'll increase you. And here it is all these years, and it hasn't happened. Where are you when the promise hasn't been fulfilled? When you're believing for healing in your body, healing in your family, when you're believing for salvations, when you're believing for prosperity, when you're believing for a husband, a wife, whatever it is you're believing for, a better job, and you're believing and it hasn't happened yet. Instead, you see the darkness and you say, Lord, I see the emptiness and I can't see the fulfillment. And Abram said, behold, thou hast given no seed, no seed, and one born in my house is mine heir. And this is what God told him in verse 4. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. See, if you would listen very closely to the word of the God, it's always coming to you. He says, my word shall not pass away. Heaven and earth might pass away, but not my word. He says, my words are spirit and life. He says, I am the word. In the beginning was the word. And you know it, the word was with God. The word is always coming at you. But you have to do something with the word that is coming at you. So God had to take a hold of Abram again. And he said in verse 5, and he brought him forth abroad and said, look now. Look at the word. See the promises. See it happening in your life. See the fulfillment. He says, look now toward heaven. Look at the stars, if you're able to count them. So shall your seed be. God was lifting him up again by his word. Telling him again. And listen to this. And he believed the Lord, and it counted to him for righteousness. He believed God. In the midst of his defeat, in the midst of this depression, in the midst of where it looked like it wasn't going to happen, he believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, right standing with God. When you believe God, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he saith, he shall have whatsoever he saith. He's believing God now. He's standing in faith right now. Verse chapter 17. And when Abram was 99 years old, 99 years old, 24 years have passed since the promise of the promised seed. All those promises, it hasn't happened yet. The Lord appeared to Abram. What a mighty man that God appeared to him. Can you imagine if you'd be in your place of prayer and here's God? What would you do? The great I am, the Holy One, and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Now here's the stipulation. Walk before me and be thou perfect. Walk before me and be thou perfect. In other words, do the best you can. Grab a hold of God. Grab a hold of him. My grace is sufficient for you. Let my grace come upon you. And he changed his name here. Changed his name. And he tells him again, I will make thee exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations out of you. And then in chapter 18, he says in verse 10, says, and he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. Told him again. And Sarah heard it. Wonder what Sarah thought. How would you like to be Sarah, 90 years old, you know? You're going to have a baby. It's the promised seed. Because of this baby, you're going to have all the families of the earth that believe what I did for you are going to be blessed. I don't want to go there. Do you? No. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age. In other words, God waited till it was totally impossible for them to give birth. There are things that you are believing for in this natural realm that are totally impossible. But your God will do it for you. Be thou perfect. Walk before me with an upright heart. Yeah. And in verse 13, and the Lord said unto Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh? I think I'd laugh too. Shall I of a surety bear a child which I am old? She said. And then in verse 14, this is what God says. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Now you got to remember that. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? I remember the day that we had no business. There was nothing there, and we had multitude of bills. And we walked the building, and we walked it, and we walked around and around and around. Is there anything too hard for God? Is there anything too hard for your God? There is nothing impossible for God. The Bible says in Mark 11:22, have faith in God. You have faith in man, and man will fail you. You have faith in woman, woman will fail you. You have faith in your job will fail you. Have faith in God. It is in him that I live and I move and I have my being. Paul said in the book of Acts, he says, none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear, that I may finish my course and the ministry which the Lord has given me. No matter what you tell me I'm going to go through, no matter what you say, no matter where I've been or what I have to do, none of these things move me. I'm going to finish my course. I'm going to follow after God with everything within me. I'm going to do it. And then here's the key in verse 18, and here's what God said. This is why he's going to do it for him. Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I know him, that he will command his children and shall keep the way of the Lord. to do justice and judgment, and the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he had spoken. Wow. That is heavy right here. That he will do it. I will bless him because of that. Romans 4. The Bible says that in Romans 4, 16, therefore is a faith that it might be by the grace to the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only that which is of law, but that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Now God is plainly telling us in the old and in the new that Abraham is our father. We are the seed of Abraham, and because of what Abraham did, because the blessings of God upon him, if we are from the seed of Abraham, if we are Christ, all these same blessings will be upon us. And here's what Abraham did in the interim period. He said, as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations in the presence of, see, it's, well, let me go slower. He said, I have made you the father of many nations in the presence of whom you believe, who quickeneth the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they are. Amen. That's our God. Amen. When was the last time you call those things that are as though they're not? He quickeneth the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they are. And see what Abraham did, he had hope. He believed in hope. He had such hope that he believed in hope. Great, intense, happy expectation of good is hope. He believed in hope. He believed it. The Bible says that he didn't even consider his own body, now dead, about 100 years old, or the deadness of Sarah's womb. He said, but he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. He was strong in faith, giving glory to God. How do you act about your faith? You give glory to God. He was strong in faith. He believed what God said would happen. He was strong in faith. When was the last time you were strong in faith in the midst of circumstances? Even though he was about 100 years old in the deadness of Sarah's womb. The Bible says he staggered not at the promises of God through unbelief, but he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. And he was fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able to perform. Therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness, and not to him only, but also to those of us who believe. That's a powerful statement. The Bible says in 2 Peter 1 that we have been given great and precious promises, that by these we might be partakers of the divine nature of Christ, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Therefore, with all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance. This is what all Abraham did. Perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. So there's things we must do to receive. And then at the very end, as I close, if you'll look in Hebrews 11, verse 6, I believe. He said, without faith, it is impossible to please God. For we must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Abraham was listed in the hall of faith. He was spoken of at the hall of faith because his faith was so strong. Sarah was spoken of. And if we grab a hold of this, if you read Hebrews, it says, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, through faith, through faith. All of these people were mentioned through faith, by faith. And it says they embraced the promises. They confessed the promises. And some of them didn't even receive it, but they embraced it and they confessed it. And then he says at the very end, I don't know exactly where, like 30-something. He says all these didn't get the promise. They didn't get it, but they still embraced it. He says, what more should I say, for time would fail me? What more shall I say? In other words, God's telling you, what more do you want me to tell you? What else do you need to know about faith? What more do you want me to say? I've given you all these examples. Don't you understand that it's by faith that the worlds were framed? What more should I say, for time would fail, to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises. They stopped the mouth of lions. They quenched the violence of fire. They escaped the edge of the sword. It said they turned to fight the armies of the aliens. They became valiant. They did all this. Women received their dead raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance that they might receive a better resurrection. And he names all these, and then he says at the end, all these obtained a good report through faith, but they didn't receive the promise. Who is the promise? That they should not be made perfect without us, because we have received the promise. Looking unto Jesus, the author, the finisher of our faith. For the joy that was set before him, that's you, he endured the cross, despising the shame of it, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So who is our faith? Who is our faith? Jesus, the stand up, the Son of God, the living Son of God. He's here today to increase your faith. He's here today to bless you and to strengthen you, to bring the fulfillment of the promises of the Word of God to you, what you have believing for. Your Jesus is the very fulfillment of everything that we ever need, that we ever desire. He is the life giver. He is the healer. He is the Savior. Lift your hands a moment. Say, Jesus, I thank you that you're a mighty God. I thank you for the fulfillment of your promises in my life. I take a hold of your word. I believe it. I see it. I act upon it. For your words are spirit and they are life. They are my life. They are my victory. They are my help. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Hallelujah.